Hello, I'm Selmateacher7, also known as Mr. Barry by my students. Today is day number 11 for the A+ certification class where we work with hardware and computer software. Now, today we'll be looking at external hard drives, external backups, and how to back up your data. This is part of a series where we learn to back up your data. So this part here is the main lesson. Other videos will cover how to back up your photos and how to back up your data to your Google Drive. Well, let's get started with the lesson. A+ computer hardware. What's in the news? Comcast adds a 1 terabyte cap for their Xfinity internet users. If you're a Comcast customer, chances are you're now already operating under an effective 1 terabyte data cap. This new plan, which is called the Xfinity Terabyte Internet Data Usage Plan, restricts users to 1 terabyte a month for a combined upload and download across 38 Comcast markets by November the 1st. Here's a brief look at Comcast's new rules. You can go over the 1 terabyte mark twice before you incur additional charges, but you'll be charged $10 for each 50 gigabyte block of data you use after that. If you need more data, you can pay Comcast an additional $50 for their truly unlimited data plan. But you have to commit to that fee in advance. It's not retroactive. Saving your stuff for the long haul. The best media and methods for archiving your data. Daily backup isn't archiving. If you want your data to survive the decades, you need to use the right tools. We have talked a great deal about the importance of backing up your data, but the media and methodologies that we have gone over are not generally suitable for real archiving. That means securing your data for posterity. This requires a different approach, where shelved media life and future file compatibility trump the speed and convenience and make backup palatable to the average user. First off, let me go into the details of the media types available for backup and archival purposes. First off, external hard drives. Portable hard drives are easy to use, faster than optical drives, but may need your data refreshed every few years. By far the most common backup method employed by normal, everyday folks is the external hard drive. They are fast compared to the tape and optical option, but hard drives are generally reliable for only the short term, less than 15 years. And if removed from operation and safely stored, they may last a decade or even two before magnetic properties diminish to the point of producing unrecoverable errors. In constant use, mechanical stresses shorten a drive's lifespan to only about 3 to 5 years. For the long term, hard drives on the shelf are workable but require periodic maintenance, so they are not ideal. Side note for those who are interested, that decade or two longevity figure is based on published figures for coercivity and residual magnetism for current GMR and SMR recording techniques, as well as the latest platter coatings. It features a loss of magnetic strength and signal of anywhere from 1% per year to 1% per decade. For non-operational drives, it's industry practice to refresh, that is, rewrite the data every 2 or 3 years. Consumers can do this for free with a software called DiskFresh. Now, environment is also key here. Heat, vibration, humidity, and magnetic fields, that is strong winds used to erase hard drives, can dramatically shorten operational or shelf life. A hard drive is also a mechanical device that's vulnerable to shocks. You can do everything right with your drive, but drop it on a hard floor as you pull it out of the safety deposit box, and boom, all your data is gone. Advice: if you use hard drives for archiving purposes, use them in pairs or trios, each containing a copy of the same data. Write protect them before storing them, and then rewrite the data every couple of years. External SSDs. External solid-state drives are very rugged and virtually shockproof, but the NAND they use won't hold data forever. The cells, which are electron traps, leak over time. The technology is also reliably new, so nobody's quite sure exactly how long an SSD will retain data when stored unpowered. But you won't find companies touting them for long-term backup. Figure of 10 years as the best case scenario, but don't rely on it. Advice: if you use SSDs, refresh the data on them every year or two. Replace them every 10. Better yet, you can use something else. Tape is next. Magnetic tape is still in the discussion for enterprise. It's available in very large capacities. A new Sony type can hold up to 185 terabytes. It's also removable media, so it's easy to store and handle in bulk. But tape can stretch and break, as well as be erased by magnetic fields. It's also very expensive. The handling mechanisms are finicky, and because data is stored sequentially, random retrieval is quite slow. It also suffers magnetic and physical degradation over time, though the rate is generally dependent upon the materials in use. Advice: customers, don't use tape. Okay, it's expensive and there are easier alternatives. Optical is next on our list. If you think of optical, such as CD, DVD, Blu-ray, solely as a means of movie and software delivery, it probably seems antiquated. You might also dismiss garden variety CD, DVD, and Blu-ray, recordable and rewritable disc as unsuitable archival media. You'd be right about that. They use inherently unstable organic dye-based data layers that do not last decades, unfortunately. However, there are optical discs that are unquestionably the hardiest, handiest, and archival media available to consumers. Right once a Blu-ray, that is from high to low, can last for 100 to 150 years given a relatively mild environment. We also have a company out called Melitonius, and they have the M disc, the Blu-ray R and DVD plus R right once disc. They use an even more stable data layer that is rated for 10,000 years. Only its polycarbonate outer layers reduce to that mere 1,000 years. Note, that is all theoretically, but the testing MOs were rigorous and performed by the government of France and the Navy of Department of Defense. Currently available is the 25 gigabyte, 50 gigabyte, or even 100 gigabyte. These are very expensive flavors. The Blu-ray R also has enough capacity to handle long-term backup and archival chars. The downside is a relatively slow 21 megabytes per second writing at best, suitably slower than USB 3.0 hard drives or SSDs. If you're worried about optical drives disappearing, know that optical retains a very strong presence in the archival community. as well as the enterprise. So that should give you some reassurance. Advice: despite its slow speed, Optical is perfect for archiving your most important data. Next, we're going to talk about online storage. You can try online storage and be done with it. It's super easy, convenient, and there are some very cheap online storage services such as Amazon's Glacier, Backblaze, Google Drive, and of course Microsoft's OneDrive. Now, Glacier is extremely inexpensive, at least until you need to retrieve your data. However, there are drawbacks. First off, though through the means of delivery may seem magical, and your data is often referred to as being safely stored in the cloud, in reality, it's stored on someone else's hard drives or other media. It's as safe as a given service has made it. There are your online speeds and availability. If the net went down or went away, so would your data. But on second thought, if the net did go away, would you even need data? Caveats aside, having an off-site copy of your data is one of the mantras recited by backup and archival gurus. If a flood, hurricane, fire, or ex-spouse runs your local backup, you've got another to fall back on. Advice: if you use online storage, use it as a partner to local backup. That said, it's a lot better than not archiving at all. Active archiving. I wouldn't mention active archiving at all if it weren't talked about in hard drive sales literature without explanation. Active archiving has nothing to do with hard drives per se. It's simply the act of moving data between media in a storage area network or SAN with the goal of keeping the most frequently accessed data on the fastest media such as RAM or solid state drives, and the least frequently accessed data on slower optical storage with hard drives somewhere in the middle. Methodology: there are a myriad backup strategies used by the pros and in enterprise environments. I'll forego complicated strategies that the average user, like myself, don't have the time or patience to implement, and I'll stick with the basics. Number one, the rule of three copies, that you always keep three copies of your data, a working copy, backup copy, and a backup of your backup copy, preferably at another location or off-site, as is known in the biz. In archiving, you may not work with the first copy, but stick with the rule of three or more anyway. Don't bother with trivial or unfinished data. Archive only irreplaceable data that is in its final state, legal or final or financial documents, important memorabilia, your creative efforts, etc. If you can download it again, reinstall it, or if you are still working with it, don't bother. You'll just waste time and space. Let your everyday backup take care of it for you. Also, take the opportunity to deduplicate and prune your data before you archive it. Number three, use write once media or write protect your rewritable media to mitigate the chance of accidental overwrites. You can write protect hard drives using the Windows dispart utility and the command /etc/read-only after selecting the proper drive and partition. Replace set with the word clear to make it writable again. Number four, don't use compressed files. That is a large file containing many smaller files that many backup programs create nowadays, if you at all can help it. Use a file system or a format that you know will be readable in the future, and store the data as plain files such as MS Word or Excel files or any of the other variants. Should be readable for quite some time. If you must use compression, Make sure it's something universal, such as zip. Number 5. Stay away from proprietary file formats if possible. Use universally recognized PDF or PDA, RTF, JPEG, or MPEG, etc., which are likely to be readable well into the future. It's rare to find a program anymore that doesn't export data in some standard file format. But if you use one, archive the installation files from that said program. If it's dependent upon a specific operating system or version of such, create a virtual drive or virtual machine with the software installed on the operating system and archive the whole deal. You can save the installation files for the operating system, but drivers may become an issue as hardware advances. Number 6. Don't use encryption except for truly sensitive data. Passwords can be lost or forgotten. Remember, we're talking the long haul here. Number 7. Date and document the archive. Name the media as specifically as you can. Use a piece of masking tape and a Sharpie if you have nothing else. There's no point in archiving the same data again at the next juncture. Number 8. Respect changing technologies. Just because the media lasts 100 years doesn't mean the technology used to read it will. We're only 50 years or so removed from punch cards, so the pace of obsolescence is very rapid, but hard to predict. If you see the technology you used being replaced wholesale by another, then re-archive it. That said, you can still find the means to read older ATA hard drives, and they've been around for a good 30 years now. If you look hard enough, I'm sure you can even find a means to read punch cards, even if it's in a computer museum. Now, let's do it! You can do as much or as little as you desire in terms of archiving your data. And to be perfectly honest, a single archive copy will probably see you through. However, do you really want to have that probability on your mind? Now I'm going to go over several methods here. Method number 1, using a Blu-ray burner that supports Blu-ray XL and also M-Disc, back up to your Blu-ray or HTL or M-Disc. You can also have Blu-ray or negative R or DVD plus R discs. Stay away from the regular CD DVD rewritable and the Blu-ray negative R LTH, aka phase changing media. Make 2 or 3 copies and send at least one to a family member you trust or store it in a safe deposit box somewhere. If you add data relatively slowly, add to your existing archive using regular M-disc DVDs. Now here's method number 2. Grab 2 or 3 USB 3 external hard drives. Back up your important data to them, write protect them, then store one locally and put one in a safe deposit box or send it to a trustworthy relative. Every couple of years, refresh the archive. Now you can copy it off and copy it off again, or you can use the app called Disk Fresh that we talked about earlier. And don't forget the online storage as a parallel backup with your physical backup. Do all that at least once a year, refreshing the hard drives every couple of years upon completion of a new project, etc. Personally, I archive immediately after I've done my taxes. It's that important, and unfortunately, about the same amount of fun. But do you know what's less fun? Losing your data. Here we see a little USB thumb drive for only $26 for 128 gigs. So this is a really good deal here at Newegg. and that is one way to back up your data along with your other backups. External storage is the topic of the day, but we will look at optical drives today as well. External drives comprises devices that temporarily store data or information for transporting from computer to computer. Such devices are not permanently fixed inside a computer. Advantages: external storage devices provides additional storage other than that is available within the computer or within the cloud. Data can be transported easily from one place to another. It is useful to store software and data that is not needed frequently. External storage also works as a data backup. This backup may prove useful at times such as fire or theft because important data is not lost. There are many technologies that external drives take advantage of. In this first part of the lesson, we will look at three types of storage and discover which one might be best for your particular situation. Disadvantages: if an external storage device stops working, all of the data on those devices is lost. So have a backup on a PC or at least in the cloud. External devices are physical devices that can be lost or stolen. So just remember that. You need more than one backup. Magnetic storage. This is the oldest technology in this category. Hard disk drives have been used as external devices for a very long time now. Some of their advantages are that they allow for a huge amount of storage for relatively low cost. They also have proven to be very stable. And here I found today some 3.5-inch drives. These were found over at Newegg. I found 2 terabytes for $77 and 4 terabytes for $120. Here we have some smaller, more portable drives, if that's your game. These are only 2.5 inches across, so they're called 2.5-inch drives. And I found the 2 terabyte for $80 and the 4 terabyte for only $130. In fact, this is a fantastic deal, this Seagate right here. Next up is optical storage. Optical media are the media that use laser light technology or for data storage and retrieval. And here's 3 examples. Now these can be found at Newegg for around $15 to $25 price tag. So they're not very expensive. The advantages of using an optical drive is the ability to write data to many DVDs, which is a very low-cost solution. DVD stands for Digital Versatile Disk. Its speed is much faster than CD, but not as fast as hard disks. The standard DVD-5 technology has a storage capacity of 4.7 gigabytes, which is much higher than a CD at only 700 megabytes. It is achieved by a number of design changes and higher data density. Next is Blu-ray. Blu-ray is another option for writing to removable media, but this normally costs a little bit more. But these have fallen in prices by tens of dollars in the last 6 months. And here I found one. This is a Blu-ray burner for only $66. Next on our list, solid-state storage. Flash memory is a solid-state memory. It was invented in the 1980s by Toshiba. A flash memory is a particular type of EEPROM, and that's all together is electrically erasable programmable read-only memory. It is a non-volatile memory, which means that it retains the stored information without requiring a power source. It is called solid state memory because it has no moving parts. Flash memory is different from the regular EEPROM, which is much slower. Advantages of flash memory: it has no moving parts and is therefore very durable and less susceptible to mechanical damages. It is extremely small in size and light in weight, making it used in portable devices. Flash memory transfers data at the faster rate than hard disk drives, making it better use of the USB 3.0. Flash memories are useful in devices where frequently updated data is required. And I found a number of them at Newegg for you. Here's a SanDisk, 32 gigs for $10, 64 gigs for $16, 128 gigs for less than $30. Wow, that is a terrific deal. And looks like almost like a sweet spot right there. Here we have above the 128 is 256 gigabytes for less than $70. It's only $66. And then we have 512 gigabyte for $185. So you can see here as the size goes up, the price per gig starts to go up and multiply there. So it gets very expensive. Do you want a whole terabyte in your pocket? Well, you can do it. Just go to Newegg and find this one here. This is $893 for 1 terabyte. So that is a little bit expensive for my budget. Next up is how to safely remove devices. Does it matter whether you safely remove devices as Windows requests? Yes, if you pop a memory card out of its reader or pull an external drive out of its USB port while Windows is reading or writing data, you could end up with corrupted files, unreadable media, or both. The problem is, it's not always easy to tell when Windows or an application is reading or writing data. In fact, all may seem quiet on the read-write front, but a program might be doing something behind the scenes. That's why it's essential to use the Safely Remove Hardware option, hidden and slightly confusing though it may be. The icon resides in the system tray, which you may have to expand by clicking the arrow. So here it's shown here on a Windows 7 machine. Comes up and you find this icon here, you click it, and then you click on eject your device. So the icon resides on the system tray, which you may have to expand by clicking the arrow. Click the icon and you'll see a pop-up menu listing the devices that can be safely removed. Click the one that corresponds to your memory card, flash drive, or whatever, and wait until you see the Save to Remove Hardware message. Only then can you unplug it. If you don't see the Safely Remove Hardware icon in your system tray, or if you're not quite sure which listing corresponds to your card or drive, you have another option. You can double-click Computer or My Computer to open it. And find the icon for the device, right-click it, and then choose Eject. Okay, here's my desktop. I'm going to show you how to safely remove your hardware. You click on a Windows 10 machine, you click on this carrot here, and that shows more. Bluetooth and other things are running in the background here. Look for the one that looks almost like a mouse with a tail on it. This actually refers to a USB. Click it, and then click once on your device. When you click on your device, it'll be safe to remove from your system as soon as it says safe to remove. We're now going to carry on to more cloud storage solutions. One advice: save your Google Drive storage space by moving images straight to Google Photos. When Google launched Google Photos a while ago, it introduced an option to store an unlimited number of photos and videos in the cloud using these services. While limited to 16 megapixel or smaller photos and 1080p or smaller high definition videos, it allows you to upload as many photos or videos as you can that meet these requirements. The unlimited storage option applies only to new uploads, but not for existing photos or videos stored on the Google Drive. It even has tools to turn trip pics into panos. So here's a panoramic trip here's a panoramic photo of our trip. Basically, I was playing with the children, pulling them down the sand dunes, and my wife was just snapping pictures all over the place. When we got home, Google Photos had put the photos together and made a nice panoramic picture with it. So, let me show you how to use your Google Photos app now. Alright, now, to find Google Photos, simply click on the app launcher, Google Apps, and then find Google Photos. Once you click on it, it'll open up and show you your pictures that you've taken. Now, if you haven't taken any pictures or uploaded any pictures, then it'll be blank there, and it'll have a quick introduction to Google Photos showing you how you might be able to do that. But let's learn how to use this great tool. If you look, the newer pictures will be at the top of the list, and then the older pictures drop down further and further down the list. So here we see a trip to Castle Air Force Base, and this is one of the pictures. That's a panoramic picture. You just take a number of pictures together, and Google will put those together for you. So, question might be asked, well, how do you get the pictures up there? One way is to click on Upload Photos. So if you have a large number of pictures that you've taken already, and you have them on your computer, just click on this little icon. It looks like a cloud with an up arrow. You do that, and a new window opens up showing you your pictures. You can click on all of the pictures by going Control plus A. So when you use the shortcut Control plus A, it highlights all of the pictures. Or you could say one picture, like that, just one picture. Or you can drag across too. Let me try to do that. There we go. And just get a few pictures that are highlighted, the ones which are checked. Once you've found the picture that you want to upload or the group of pictures that you want to upload, click on Open. And you'll see a notification menu up here. And it says, one item uploaded. And you can share it at that time or add to an album. Okay, now. So now you know how to upload your files that you've already taken. The other option is to have them automatically uploaded when you take them with your smartphone. Now, in order to do that, you have to have Google Photos on your iPod or Android device. Once you have Google Photos on there, you simply log into your Google account, and then the photos will be synchronized to your cloud storage, part of Google Photos. Alright, I'm going to show you some of the neat things here, some of the tools that we find. First off, you'll notice that we have a box up here to search. I can do a search for items. So if I wanted to find something, I could do that, and I'll go back to that here in a few minutes. This one here is the assistant. This is a shortcut to all of your pictures. And then these are albums. There's also more tools here, as well as a main menu up here. But let's go on to the assistant right now. Now the assistant, what it does is it takes your pictures and it puts them into albums, or it makes animations out of them. It also creates panoramic pictures out of them, so that it'll take your pictures that were done, you know, in times past, like a year ago, and it puts it into a little memory album there that you can look at. Here's 9 years ago. It will also show any photos that were shared with you by your friends and family members. And here we see it's created an album. We took a number of pictures on one Saturday and it created a new album called Saturday at Cricket Hollow Park. Made another album here Wednesday in Reedley. So it's always trying to do things for you to make your life easy for you. Next is albums. If I click on albums, it'll show albums that you have made and also the albums that were made by Google Photos. So here we see Trip to LA. This was a photo album made by Google Photos for me, from my pictures of my trip to LA. And we just see a number of albums, such as Thursday at Atwater, that was at the Castle Air Force Museum up there. And all these are albums that it's created. So it's wonderful. You, like I said, you can create your own albums as well. These are shared, so people, places, things, videos, and colleges. Now on the three dots here, we bring that up, and now we have the assistant, photos, and albums again, shared, the trash can. You can click on any of your pictures or albums and trash them. You can go into your settings and change how the assistant helps you, but I leave all those to being the way they came because I just enjoy having the assistant do those things for me. And then we also have send feedback or help, and we also have app downloads if you want to download the Google Photos app for your iPhone or Android smartphone. Alright, now let's go up here to the search. Let's say that I wanted to find something. I click up here and what happens is it changes to this window. Notice I can search by a word, by a face, or I can look by the file type, such as videos, selfies, screenshots, movies, and there's even more. Places, so I can search by a place as well. What I'm going to do right now is show you some amazing technology here. I'm going to look for a person by simply looking at their face. So I'm going to click on this button here. Then we get this window that comes up. Now this shows all of the faces of people that I've taken photos of. Now I may not know these people. They might have been in the background of my pictures. Some of them may be in the foreground too. But a lot of these were in the background, so I don't know a lot of these people back here. Alrighty. Let's say that you noticed already that there's names on these. Well, it's very easy to do this, to add names to the photos here. You simply would find a person who you haven't added a name to, such as Loopy here. So you click on Loopy and it says, who is this? And you look down, you can see, oh yeah, those are all pictures of Loopy through the years. You go over here and you say, well, that's Loopy. And it sees, well, there's other people who I've known and people in contacts. Well, it's none of these. So I'll just say done. And now I've added my own personal label called Loopy. I can edit it or delete it if I want to, simply by clicking on the little pin here. Okay, let's go back here. And let's just click on another person here. Okay, I clicked on a random person here and all of their pictures comes up. No matter where that individual is, even if they're way in the background of the picture, like right here, go find them. Here they are way in the back and it still found the person. For pictures that were taken like this, a whole bunch of pictures of the same scene, it'll put it together and create an animation of it for you. So here we see the person again way in the background. So wherever It even recognizes the person when they're not facing the camera. Like in this shot here. That's her. But she's turned away from the camera. Here she's basically all the way. You don't even see her face at all. You just see part of her ear. Yet Google Photos knew that that was the same person as this person, say. So that's just amazing technology. And let me show you something here. Here's another picture. It looks like there's no people in this picture, right? But you click it, and oh, there she is way in the background there, saying hi to us from the rocks. And it'll also keep all these for you, and it puts them by date. So it puts all the dates on there for you when it believes the pictures were taken. So here we see July, October 2007, December 2007, and the newer dates are towards the top. Okay, now to do another search, you click on the arrow here, and you can do another kind of search. Now, let's say that you are looking for something specifically, such as a waterfall. Well, you type in waterfall, hit enter, and it brings up all of the waterfalls. Now, how did it do that? Well, there's artificial intelligence being used here by Google Photos. It looks at every one of the photos and determines what's in the picture, and then it puts on those keywords for you, so you don't have to. So anytime it sees a waterfall, it'll put those keywords in for you. Here we also see that it was here at this national park. Let's do another search here. This time, let's type picnic and see if it finds picnics. Aha! Look at that. It finds all the picnic pictures. So it can recognize picnics there. So it's working very well as finding all the pictures related by the scene. What's happening in the pictures there. And again, you notice that it sorts it by the dates. Let's now do a search for birthday and see if it finds, aha! You may say, well, this is a space scene, but if you look in there, it says Daniel Hope Frank's birthday is out of this world. So it says birthday in the picture. Here's more birthday pictures. Lots and lots of birthdays. So it is easy to find your pictures. You don't have to worry about organizing your pictures anymore because it'll organize the stuff for you. Well, that was our segment on using Google Photos to have a safe place for your photos. Now we're going to go to the Google Drive and show you how to use that next. Okay, here we see the Google Drive. Now, the Google Drive is set up so that you can very easily create new folders by simply clicking on New and then Folder, and you give it a name and it saves it here. You can also do a file or a folder upload in case you already have data saved on your computer that you want to back up and never lose. An easy way, for example, is to go Folder Backup and then choose the one folder that holds all of your other folders, such as the My Documents, and back up everything that way at one shot. You also can create a new document, which is very similar to Microsoft Word. In fact, Google Docs will open Microsoft Word as if you were in Microsoft Word. You also have Google Sheets and Google Slides. This shows you your location of where you are. So if I went to Smartphone Repair, you notice now I'm in My Drive, and I'm in the subfolder called Smartphone Repair. If I go back out to the root directory, I go here. Now I can search any of my documents or anything. So if I click up here, and I begin typing something such as a word, like backspace, any document that has that particular word in the document comes up. So that tells me that all of these different lessons use the word backspace in them. So it looks not only for the title, but also for words within the document. All right, this is the grid view or detail view. So if I click on it, there's one way to see everything. If I click on, so this is called list view. If I click on grid view, there's grid view there, or vice versa. Yeah, this is grid view here, I guess. And then list view. Now I have view details, so I can click on any of the folders or any files and view the details of them. And then over here I have settings if I want to change some of the settings. You probably notice right away on some of my folders, they have different colors. What I got to do is right click on one. When you right click on it, you can do all kinds of things. You can share it with somebody. You can move it. You can add a star to it to show you that it's important to you. You can also change the color, rename, view details, download it, or even put it in the trash. Now here I'll change the color of this one to green. So I click on green and right away it changes to green up here. So it's very easy to back up your data here. So remember, when you want to back up your data, such as important Word documents or other things that you never want to lose, click on New and then go Folder Upload, and then just back up the entire folder that holds your work. Alrighty, that was Google Drive in a nutshell. I hope you guys get to use it out there in lab today. Well, that was our lesson number 11. All talked about external storage as well as backing up your data. Hope you give a thumbs up. And please subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already. Well, have a very good day now. Bye-bye.